That's me. Okay, it's easy to recognize, you know, the guy with the shirt, right? This is the Aloha shirt, so very easy to spot me anywhere in the world. You know, I always wear such things. So, yes, today I'm going to talk about, you know, the fact that there is no artificial intelligence. I mean, I'm going to, you know, moderate a little bit what I'm talking about right now by the fact that the artificial intelligence that doesn't exist is the one that you are hearing about for about, you know, 5, 6, 7 years in the media. Okay, so if you are doing any kind of AI, the one that you are doing is most likely, you know, still there. Okay, but the one that doesn't exist is the one that, unfortunately, you know, we are hearing a lot about. And this is the one that, you know, made me write a book that is called, you know, There is No Such Thing as Artificial Intelligence. First of all, I mean, in order to explain why, you know, there isn't the thing that they are talking about, we need to go through the history of AI. It's going to be quick, but artificial intelligence, it really started, you know, in 1956. 1956, it was when the actual name was, you know, used for the first time. And it was done in Dartmouth University. And some people there decided that they could model with mathematics, with a simple mathematical function, actually, they could model a neuron. Right. So they said, if I have a neuron that I can model, then I can have a neural network. And if I have a neural network, I have a brain. If I have a brain, I have intelligence. So obviously, you know, this is totally stupid. Right? And it didn't work. And I'm going to show you that later. But it's an issue that we started, you know, by calling this thing artificial intelligence when it has nothing to do, it had nothing to do with intelligence. So this is my main issue. Anyway, I'm going to go back to that, but first I'm going to talk about what is it that we wanted to do, really, you know, what is it, this artificial intelligence that we want to create? It's, after all, you know, some tools that are going to augment us, to do something for us, right? So we could actually go very, very, very far in history in order to find, you know, some tools that are interesting. But because I'm French, you know, and because I'm, you know, very, very French, I'm going to start artificial intelligence in 1642. What was 1642? 1642 was the first computer, the first, you know, calculator, basically, done by Pascal, la Pascaline, you know. And Pascal was a very smart guy, as you know, he was French, of course. And so Pascal created this first thing that was very, very simple, actually, but very, very useful, because it was doing just simple, you know, addition and subtractions. But, you know, it's not that easy to do addition and subtraction. If I ask you right now, you know, what is 1792 plus 499? I'm pretty disappointed. I mean, it doesn't mean that you are not intelligent. You could think about that, right? I mean, the for sure thing is that the machine there, you know, in 1642, it would have done the result, you know, in less than 3 seconds, right? You, all the smart guys, you know, around the room, nobody got me the result. I'm very, very disappointed. But anyway, so the fact is that it might not mean that you are stupid, you know. It might mean that, you know, this is not intelligence. We can think about that. Anyway. So let's go back to my friends, you know, in 1956. Not only, you know, they started with the wrong, you know, definition, let's say, but also they started to try to solve something that is very, very, very difficult. The most difficult thing, certainly, you know, that you want to solve is natural language, right? So they started to say, you know, we are going to build this computer that is going to understand natural language. And natural language is certainly, again, the most difficult thing. This is a unique thing for us. Descartes, you know, said the language is something that is unique to the human being, right? So this is something that is very, very complex. And guess what happened? They failed, of course. Okay? So because it's way too complicated, it's still very, very complicated, but it was impossible to do. And what happened also at the time, you know, after 4 years, basically, we entered something that we call the first winter of AI, right? What is the winter of AI? I mean, it was decided that, you know, we shouldn't fund this thing because they promised a lot of stuff and they didn't deliver. So this is exactly what could happen today, if we continue to say bullshit, you know, about AI. Because today, a lot of people are saying a lot of bullshit. And this is exactly what I'm saying, that we shouldn't call that AI, because we are going to disappoint a lot of people if we continue to promise, you know, the stuff that we are promising. Okay? So I don't want to enter a new winter of AI, because our AI, my AI, the one that I'm working on for 30 years, exists. And it's very interesting. It's going to create some incredible systems. We shouldn't stop because some stupid people, you know, are saying bullshit. Okay? That said, in the 70s, you know, it continued actually. I mean, some people continued to try to model something, you know, in that could look like a brain. And it was what we were calling at the time, you know, expert systems, right? So it's basically logic system, right? It's rule-based systems. So expert systems, it went, you know, through the 60s, 70s, 80s. I'm moving that away a little bit. 70s, 80s, 90s, you know, and we had a lot of very, very good programs, actually, that were working pretty well, right? Rule-based, pretty simple. And actually, the thing that we saw, you know, the best program ever was certainly something in 1997 that was called, you know, Deep Blue, right? Deep Blue was this IBM machine that actually defeated Kasparov at chess. Chess, yeah, very, very smart. You know, chess, right? Chess is smart. Chess is 10 at the power of 49 position on the board, right? About. 10 at the power of 49 positions. It's a lot of rules, but simple rules when you think about that. And, you know, it's very easy, after all, to model, you know, with those expert system things. And also at the time, in the mid-90s, it was the very first time we had calculators that could actually, you know, had enough power to calculate from a position to the to victory, basically, because we were able to model every single of the 10 at the power 49 position on the board. So it wasn't that intelligent, actually. This is what I'm claiming. Anyway, it was pretty impressive, and it's something that we need to recognize. But I don't think that it was that there was any intelligence there. In the 90s, I mean, the thing that that continued, you know, where people that were actually hiding doing neural networks. I was one of them, you know. It wasn't very popular to do neural networks in the 90s, but we were still trying because we were thinking that maybe there might be something. And so it's called now machine learning, but something happened actually in the mid-90s. Something happened that is very, very interesting. It's called the internet, okay? And the internet is very interesting. Why? Because, I mean, those neural networks, what are they? I mean, they are based on data. And, you know, the internet is certainly the biggest database in the world, right? And, of course, when you think about deep learning now, this is something that needs even more data, you know? And in 2007, you know, thanks to, you know, a lot of things that were happening on the internet and a lot of data that was on the internet, we were able to prove some of the theories that we had, you know, for the past, let's say, 20 years. Here, I'm going to lose about half of you, but I'm going to bring you back in the thing after that. But I'm going to lose you when I'm going to say that on the internet, there were a lot of cats, images of cats, right? So why? I mean, personally, I hate cats, you know, so I don't really care about cats. But the thing is that it was very interesting that there were cats on the internet because people were taking pictures of cats and they were saying, oh, this is my catty, my kitty, my cat. And the good thing is that they built an incredible large database of cats, okay? And it was a database of cats that was actually annotated. So we knew that it was a grand truth, right? Images of cats. Very good. Now I'm bringing you back. Those cats, they allowed us, you know, to basically verify those methods, you know, that we had, you know, in our minds, because we had now those large databases, you know, and we succeeded, you know, to create the very first cat recognition system, you know, with about 100,000 images of cats, right? Impressive. So with 100,000 images of cats, we were able, you know, to recognize cats in an image at about 98%. Well, pretty good. Is it that good? Do you have any idea, you know, what is it that we need, us, you know, humans? How many cats do we need to recognize cats forever?
One?
According to the psychologists, you know, it's two. It's not far, you know, pretty good, I mean. But you compare, you know, one or two, to 100,000, this is a difference, right? And what I'm saying here is basically, you know, those systems that need, you know, 100,000 images, they are totally different from our system. Okay? We need two. Again, when you think about it, we don't need two images of cats. We need two instances of cats, which is very, very different, because an image of cat is something, you know, that is just flat and that is, you know, something that is coming from a picture. An instance of cat is something that you see, you know, going around. It's not going that way, right? It's something that has many more parameters that you as a human being, you can integrate with, in a lot of different dimensions, in a lot of different contexts, that we don't give to those machines, you know, when we do just image recognition, but that we might do one day, but we don't do today because multimodality is very, very complex, right? But think about that. But anyway, so bottom line, those very smart AI systems, they are pretty stupid because they need, you know, that many images, right? Another example of that, you know, is even more interesting, I think. And it happened, you know, a few years later. It's when this beautiful machine here, you can admire, you know, my graphics, right? And at the same time, please, I mean, thank you very much. So this machine here is DeepMind, okay? DeepMind with, I mean, running AlphaGo in 2016. In 2016, AlphaGo, you know, beat the best, the world champion at Go. Go, that's an intelligent game, right? Go is, you have to be very, very intelligent for that. What is intelligent, what is interesting in Go is that this time it's not 10 to the power of 49 positions that you have on the board. It's a little bit more, okay? If you ask mathematicians, they are going to tell you that you have in Go between between 10 to the power of 172 and 10 to the power of 542. So what does that mean, what I just said? It means that we have no fucking idea, okay? We don't know, we just don't know. But let's say that it's 10 to the power of 200. 10 to the power of 200. There are some people, you know, when I give this very conference, you know, they are saying, oh, 10 to the power of 200, it's only 4 times more than 10 to the power of 50. I'm happy you are laughing, because sometimes I'm not, because when they say that, I think, okay, so let's go back to the beginning, right? So anyway, so 10 to the power of 200, let's say that it's that. And basically, it's infinite. See what it is, right? I mean, do you know how many atoms there is on our world? 10 to the power of 136, okay? So 10 to the power of 200, it's a lot. Okay, so let's say it's infinite, it's a lot of things. So I'm not going to go into, you know, the way the machine actually defeated this guy, you know, the Korean, the 19-year-old Korean champion, you know. So machine was good, not because of the memory size or because of the calculation, but it was good because we used some of those techniques here that were, you know, deep learning techniques, because we gave basically to the machine 30,000 games of Go that were, you know, put plus the rules, and then, you know, it did defeat the thing. But we don't care about techniques. What is interesting is to understand this guy here. This guy, it's 1,500 CPUs. CPUs, chips in your computer, right? 1,500 CPUs. 300 GPUs. GPUs, same thing, chips, but that time, you know, it's for the screen, for displays, and it allows you matricial calculation, right? So a little bit stronger. And 30 TPUs for the ones, you know, who are doing AI. TPUs is basically tensor processing unit. This is specifically for to do TensorFlow. This is a chip done by Google to do TensorFlow, right? It's a technique for deep learning. Okay, so basically it's 2,000 computers. It's a small data center. It's 440 kilowatts. 440 kilowatts to play Go. 440 kilowatts to play Go. Interesting. But what is much more interesting is this guy. You, and most of you. Do you know how much do we have there in this thing? Do you have an idea? What is it? You know? Depends again, but it's it's between 20 and 25 watts. 20,000 times less. 20,000 times less. And this guy does something else than paying Go, hopefully. Right? He does a lot of stuff. This thing only plays Go. That's an issue. It's a big issue. I'll come back to that. So anyway, 2016 again, you know, we are playing with all those data, a lot of data. And everything now, all the AI is about data, right? And it's a big issue because we can have data bias. What is that? You can choose the wrong data sometimes when you program. Now you program with data instead of programming with rules, right? And if you choose the wrong data, you can have some very bad systems. And this is an issue, you know, when you are going to create one, and I have an example of one of them. This is this one. This is a chatbot created by Microsoft in 2016. You heard about it, maybe. It was Thai, T-A-Y, Thai, a chatbot that was going on Twitter to promote the Microsoft products, right? Very good idea. In the history of chatbots, it's pretty, you know, short, but in the history of chatbot, it became instantaneously the most racist and sexist chatbot in the world, okay? It did insult, basically, you know, everybody that it was talking to, especially if they were black or female, okay? Why? Why does it happen? It happens because of this data bias thing that I was talking about, but there were actually two issues. First issue, pretty simple. It's only a classic programming issue, you know, so it's a bug. The bug was basically when you create a chatbot, you create something that is going to integrate well in your audience, right? So it has to talk like your audience. And it happens that I heard, because I'm not on Twitter, that on Twitter, after two or three interactions, you insult each other. Okay? So here, the adaptability factor that was for the conversation was pretty high. So pretty easy fix, you know, you lower the adaptability factor, and then, you know, it's going to talk like you want it to talk. Ah, okay, easy. The other one is much more difficult, is the data. I was talking about the cats, you know, earlier, that there are a lot of cats on the internet. It's easy, you know, to find and so on. It's not easy to find conversation, annotated conversation on the internet. Very complicated, right? And there are actually none that you can really rely upon. But it happens that there is a database that is very well known for people who are doing speech recognition, who are doing natural language, that is called Switchboard. This is a database that exists, you know, for years in the States. And this is an annotated database of conversation of real people talking over the phone to call centers, right? So a lot of data. So of course, the Microsoft guys, you know, they needed some kind of those conversations. They took a subset of that. And the subset that they took, potentially, is the conversation in the 50s in the South States of the USA. I'm happy that you are laughing too, because sometimes when I say that, you know, especially in the States. Really? Yeah. Anyway, so you got it. No? The thing by default, it was racist. You know, it started racist. It was trained on a racist database, basically. Okay? So be very, 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 very careful. Okay. I'm going to talk about this one here. This one, that's not supposed to be like that, but that's okay. So imagine here, you have a black box. Okay? It's weird. Okay. Black box. Artificial intelligence. You cannot explain it. No. It's a black box. Okay, so I have one scoop, I have two scoops for you today. So this is the first one. First one, there is no inexplicability of AI. We can explain AI. It's complicated, but you can explain AI. So it means that AI is done by us, for us, and we have the control. I will repeat that several times today. But when you create a system, whoever creates it, they can basically explain everything mathematically, because it's only math, as I said before, right? It's only rules, logics, or it's only statistics that are based on the data, and the algorithms are going to be working on those data, and we can explain actually the step by step. The only issue is that this is very difficult to explain if you want to do it practically. Because at every single step, the computer that we're talking about is going to do something like millions of calculations a second. So practically, you cannot explain it because you cannot follow that. You will need, you know, a few hundred years or 1,000 years to explain the actual thing. But mathematically, you can explain it. I'm going to give you an example, actually, of another case that is easier to understand now, because all those inexplicability thing happens, you know, in the history all the time. 1914. It's not that long, you know. There is a very good mathematician. The name was Gaston Julliard. Very good guy. Gaston Julliard invented or discovered the fractals. Our people here, you know, if you know what a fractal is, you have immediately an image in your head that forms, right? So you know what a fractal is. The other one who don't know what a fractal is, go to Wikipedia. Gaston Julliard, log, very simple equation actually, that shows that every iteration is going to give the same result of the previous iteration. It's basically what it is. So it's not very easy to explain if you are not a mathematician. So it was mathematically explainable, but practically unexplainable. 40 years later, 1955, Julliard is a teacher at Polytechnique, not too far from here, and he has a student who is called Mandelbrot. Mandelbrot, you know, is a good student. He listens well. He goes to the States. He goes to IBM. He's given a machine that can plot, you know, any kind of equation. And he plots the equation and appears this image that, you know, you had in your head when I talked about fractal the first time. And this image, you know, is obvious because you see what it is, you know. You see that actually every single iteration of the image when you take, you know, a magnificent glass or whatever. So you take that, you go, you know, inside and you see, you know, at every single level of iteration, you see the same drawing that you had before. Okay? Very impressive, very interesting, very nice, actually, very, very cute. But what was unexplainable, you know, before, 40 years later, became explainable very, very simply through a drawing. I'm not saying that in 40 years we'll be able to explain AI, you know, through a single simple drawing. But I'm saying that a lot of people, you know, are working on that, and that I'm sure that at one point we'll be able to explain what we think today that is unexplainable. Okay? Okay, since I'm in the part, you know, where I'm a little bit... Oh, here it is. That's good. Yeah, so it was there as well. Okay, that doesn't matter. Okay, so next step is I'm going to talk about one of my favorite subjects. It's the autonomous car. Autonomous driving. So this is the second scoop of the day, right? So first scoop of the day was there is no inexplicability. Second scoop of the day, autonomous car will never exist. Never. Not in 200 years, not in 2,000 years. Never. You spell never like never, yeah? And I'm going to prove it. Because, and of course, I'm going to explain what is autonomous cars. I'm not talking about level 4. You know, maybe that there are five levels today, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What I'm saying is that level 5 will never exist. Not with the methods that we're talking about, which are those methods, you know, that are just mathematics, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 is full autonomy. The thing, you know, will handle everything, anything, at any point with anybody, not touching, you know, anything in the car. It will just, you know, go. This one will never exist. Level 4, that is going to be very, very, very good, you know, much better than us, is going to exist. It will be great. Because it's going to save a lot of lives. So we shouldn't lie on level 5 because level 4 will be very, very good. But why is level 5 never going to exist? Two examples. The first one is maybe, you know, a little bit more difficult here. It's easier when I'm in Paris. The first one is called Place de l'Étoile at 6 p.m. Place de l'Étoile at 6 p.m., you know, you have a lot of cars everywhere. You know, you have 10 or 12 avenues, you know, coming in this thing, you know, and it's a deadlock. Yeah, it's a deadlock. So it's not what you learn, you know, when you go to learn how to drive. It's not that. It's sociology, you know, it's negotiation. It's everything you can think about, but knowing how to drive. Okay? So you're going to tell me, yeah, of course, but you know, I could program the thing that is going to do thanks to V2X. You know, V2X is vehicular communication. Thanks to V2X, it's going to negotiate and it's going to do all that. So yes, yeah, be my guest, do it. So you're going to create in 2 years, you know, a very nice car that is going to be able to go through the Place de l'Étoile in 2 hours. Congratulations. Now, this very car, take it to Bangalore. I don't know if you ever saw how to drive in Bangalore, you know, but if you saw that it was difficult at Place de l'Étoile, Bangalore is Olympic Games, okay? It's another level. So the same car won't work there. And what I'm saying is that there will always be an exception. There will always be something that is make your car stop or not working correctly. And I have actually an example that is even better than this one. And this is what I found, you know, from Waymo. Waymo is certainly the most advanced company today in autonomous driving, right? They are doing that for 10 years. They drove with their car more than 11 million miles. 11 million miles, it's a lot of miles, right? And they did record everything. And recently, the CEO of Waymo said, in March this year, he said, level 5 will never exist. 10 years, good. You know, it took him 10 years, but that's okay. So at least he said it. But another thing that he did release every single video of the 11 million miles on YouTube. So you can go to watch those 11 million miles yourself. It's boring. Little bit boring. It's basically, you know, everything that is inside Palo Alto and Mountain View and something like that, and you see, you know, the car going around and, you know, and they are collecting data and collecting data. Very good. But, of course, I'm going to watch it because I love it. My son tells me that I'm a little bit stupid, but I still love it, you know, and I'm like that, looking for the gem, right? And I found one of the gems. I'm sure there are many, but I found one that is just incredible. So you see this car, you know, you have a camera that is behind the windshield, and the car, you know, is driving through the roads of Mountain View or Palo Alto, or I don't know where, totally boring, nothing happens, you know. And in the middle of nowhere, with no reason, the car stops. Okay? And then after 2 seconds, you know, the thing goes for 2 meters, it stops. And then again, 2 meters, stops. And then we feel that the operator, because there is a guy, you know, behind the wheel, he takes back the control, you know, and drives away, because the guys behind him, you know, they were a little bit nervous, most likely. So you say, what happens? So now you look at the video a little bit, you know, closely, and you see that there are two guys walking, you know, on the sidewalk. Okay, two guys walking on the sidewalk, it's not that an issue. But then you look a little bit closer again, and one of the two guys on the sidewalk, on his shoulder, he has a stop sign. So, this case, of course, today, you know, there is something, a rule in the thing that says, if there is a jerk on the side with a stop sign, don't stop, okay? So it's there, it's good. But I think that you, if you see someone on the side of the sidewalk, you know, walking with a stop sign, you don't stop, right? I hope. Okay, but I mean, the reality is that there is always a case somewhere that is not going to be in the database. Because all these things that we are talking about, you know, it's based on rules or data. The rules, we build them. The data, they exist. And frankly, I mean, the data of having a guy with a stop sign on the shoulder, it's pretty difficult to imagine or to capture, right? Somewhere that is not going to be in the database. Because all these things that we are talking about, you know, it's based on rules or data. The rules, we build them. The data, they exist. And frankly, I mean, the data of having a guy with a stop sign on the shoulder, it's pretty difficult to imagine or to capture, right? So there will be always a case somewhere that's not going to work. Next usually here I do a little chapter, you know, on Siri, right? Because I mean, everybody is saying, you know, this guy is the grandfather of Siri or whatever. So, okay, so I need to explain a little bit. And somewhere, you know, I take the blame if people think that computers can be smart, you know? Because the movie Her, that you most likely saw, you know, is something that is coming directly directly from Siri. And this is something that, you know, makes believe that potentially you can fall in love you know, speech assistant, which I hope you won't do. And this thing, you know, can be anything for you, right? It's not true. Okay, this is actually a stupid system. Okay, and because we realized that it was a stupid system, we actually made it more stupid than what it was to make it more human. When you didn't succeed to do that earlier, you showed you were human or stupid. So what is it that I'm talking about here? Basically, we knew that the speech recognition was bad enough that it was only about 80% of them. Siri, the very first version, was in 1997. Okay, the very first patent. So it was a long time ago. It went to the public only in 2010, 11, but in 1997, the speech recognition was about 80% accurate. It's not a lot, right? 80% accurate, imagine a book where you have 300 words in a page, you have 60 of them that are missing. It's not easy to understand the page, right? So it was exactly what it was. So we came up with an idea saying that we are not better than the others. The others were saying they were much better, you know, and they were saying 80% is pretty good and so on. We said 80% is shit. But what we are going to do, we are going to make people believe that it's not that shit, you know, that it's actually pretty good. How are you going to do that? You are going to theorize the thing by saying you are going to create artificial stupidity. So what is artificial stupidity? Artificial stupidity is based on the theory that I worked on for years that I called the nightclub paradigm. This is the second time when I lose people usually. Okay? So nightclub paradigm. What is the nightclub paradigm? Nightclub paradigm, a lot of noise. A little bit drunk. And then, you know, there is a guy that is talking to you, you know, and interesting, there is something to do, right? So, I mean, we are talking, interesting, the guy is talking, and you don't understand anything, I mean, about, you know, 80% of what he says, but, you know, you want to be socially, you know, nice and so on, so, okay. And after a while, you know, the guy really insists, you know, so you need to do something. So what is the very first step of artificial stupidity? It's the first step, easy. Okay. Second step, now the guy continues because he feels that you are engaged, right? So he continues to talk to you. Second step, after a while, you have your self-esteem, right? I mean, somewhere, so I mean, you need to do something. And what you're going to do, you're going to talk, right? And you're not going to be able to talk about anything that he talked about because you don't have no fucking idea what it is, right? So you are going to talk about something else. And you are going to tell him a joke in order to do something else. And the guy, you know, doesn't matter, he's drunk as well. So, but at the end of the day, you have a conversation, or it looks like a conversation. This is exactly what we did with Siri. We added, you know, those little jokes, or little thing, you know, that made Siri kind of engaging where she didn't understand anything. Okay? So that was one of the things. But that said, I mean, this technology wasn't that stupid in the sense that we actually saved lives with Siri. So people don't believe it, right? But I'm going to tell you one story, but there are many of them. One story is one guy one day, you know, was in the middle of the States, in the South States somewhere, and he was working on his car. And he was behind the car, you know, it was hot, nobody, you know, 40 miles around, right? And he was working on the car, and the car, you know, falls on the guy. The leg sectioned, right? Blood is going out, he's dead in, you know, half an hour. Can move, the car is there, done. Until he thinks, it's good to have a brain sometimes. So he thinks what? He thinks, oh, in my back pocket, I have Siri. Hey Siri, call 911, beep, beep, done. Okay? He actually told the story, so he's still alive. Okay? So anyway, sometimes, you know, technology is good. you know, and AI can save lives. Okay, so AI. I'm talking about AI, AI all the time. So I want to keep the AI letters. But I don't want to keep the artificial intelligence name. Okay, so I'm going to call it augmented intelligence. It's not the domain that I'm going to call augmented intelligence. It's the fact that this AI that I'm talking about is augmenting us. This is our AI. This is us. This is us controlling it. This is us deciding what to do with it. And it's a tool, and it's only a tool that we fully control. Like every other tool, we can decide to make something bad with it. This is our choice. This is not the choice of AI. This is our choice. Any tool, let's take, you know, a hammer. Hammer is a good tool, right? It's a pretty old tool. It's better than, you know, trying to put a nail in the wood or something with your finger or with your hand, right? So a hammer is good. A hammer is good until you use it, you know, to hit the guy on the head. Not good. That's why you need sometimes, you know, regulation. So you are going to need regulation for every single technology. AI will need regulation as well. Okay, to understand the power of the thing and to understand what you cannot do with it. But this is you not doing it, not doing something with it. Okay, we are in charge. And to sum up this thing, I'm going to draw, if you like this thing, this image, the next one is even better. Okay, I like the teasing part, right? Beautiful. I'm going to draw intelligence. Okay, so we have here, you know, on this axis here, we have the level of intelligence, 0, Trump, 100, a genius, okay? Here we have the domains of intelligence. Don't know what it is. Mathematics, you know, Go, chess, I don't care. Domains of intelligence. And here, this is us. We are pretty good. We are pretty good, we're okay. We're in good shape, right? We're not geniuses. But we are better than Trump. So we are pretty good, right? And what is interesting here is that not only we are pretty good, but we are pretty good at everything. If I look at each single pixel there, you know, we are good at everything. Every single thing, we have an opinion. We can say something about it. Even if we don't know anything, we can say something, right? So we are good at everything. And what is even more interesting, it's continuous mathematically, you know, if you take it, you know, mathematically. But what is even more interesting is that it's continuous and infinite. It means that today, right now, if you invent something, right, collectively, we are all going to be able to say something about it. Because we can. And this is our brain. We invent stuff all the time, right, over the course of our history. So we are continuous and infinite. So let's look now at AIs, because we say AIs, okay? The one at chess. So this is me at chess. I drew the thing, so I do whatever I want, right? So I'm pretty good, right? But where is the AI at chess?
Of course, it's there.
It has every single, you know, position on the thing, so it knows everything. It's a genius, right? Pretty good. Where is Go? Go is interesting because it's more than a genius. Because there are so many, you know, positions possible and so many that we didn't see in the humanity yet, that this thing is, you know, suprahuman. Right? And that's fine. But it's only at Go. It's 440k watts. Unbelievable. Driving. Level 4, you know, not level 5. Level 5, remember, won't never exist, okay? Pretty good. This is us, you know, we are driving, but we are texting while driving. We are a little bit drunk, you know, so it's better. So let's build it, okay? Be sure to build it. This one is something else. I will talk to it a little bit later. And, you know, anything, we are going to be able to just build something that is better than us on every single domain. But what is it that I just drew here? I just drew, you know, for every single domain, a very specialized AI, right? So for every of them, potentially have to build something that is going to be, you know, 440 kW, which is way too much. And this is what is called discrete in mathematics, right? So instead of continuous, like it was for us, it's discrete. So you need an infinity of discrete points like that, you know, in order to create the infinite. It's going to be a lot, right? In addition to that, I mean, when you look at some things, they are here. If I drew that, it's because to say that some of the domains, they are going to be very, very close. And some people say, yeah, so we are going to be able to do some transfer learning from one domain to another. I say, yeah, very, very good. So we are going to be able to learn some of those things. Unfortunately, between two domains, you know, that are very close, there is actually, again, the infinite there. So there will be cases that are going to be okay in some domains that you cannot translate in another domain, actually. So it's not going to work well. But even more interesting is to look here. What is it here? Where is the AI there? Where are the AIs there? Where do you think they are? Nowhere. Why? There is no rules. There is no data. There's nothing yet. We didn't invent it yet. We didn't invent it yet. The day we will invent it, okay, we'll create an AI that will be better than us. But we have to wait a little bit before that. Anyway, so with the current methods, which are mathematics, you know, logic and statistics, DI, we are in full control side, and this is our game to lose. We decide, you know, to give it away and to give the keys to AI, we can. We can say, you know, do whatever you want, but we will decide. Thank you.
There used to be all this kind of talk about logic-based AI. Where, I mean, is there a hope that it will be mixed with database-based AI and kind of go much further than we are?
So I think that, I mean, you know, we started actually with the statistical one. We stopped. Then we went to the logic one, which was the expert system, basically. Then we, you know, went back to something that seems to be very interesting, which is, you know, those deep learning, machine learning thing that based on data, right? And now actually there is a new school that says, okay, we need to start to combine again, you know, those two things because we are going to get, I mean, very good results. So there are a lot of people, you know, working on that right now, you know, to combine again, I would say, because some people tried actually in the past as well. But now the computation level is at such a point that we can really try to do it. We are going to get some better results, I'm sure, because as soon as you, you know, combine something, usually, you know, the combination is better than the thing by itself, right? So I'm sure we'll get some better results. But I'm sure that we will never, you know, go, you know, higher than those things there. I mean, we will never go to perfect on everything. If there is a way to create a new AI, so an AI that will look like us one day, maybe, you know, like the thing that we have there, first of all, we need to be sure that we're not going to use that much data, okay? Because using big data is not the solution. Using big data, we saw, you know, we go directly in the wall, you know, when we think about the energy. Right? So we need to be very, very careful about that. So we need to have another paradigm that is not going to be math. And what is it? I mean, I don't know, but I feel that it's going to be something that is closer to what is up there. So it's going to be closer to biology. You know, maybe, you know, people are talking about quantum physics. Might be something like that that is going to be much closer to this thing here. So if you want to be optimistic, one day maybe, you know, we'll have something that will look like us, you know, but it will have to use some totally other paradigm than the mathematics.
Staying with old-style data-based AI, and you look at the right side of your diagram, economists are talking a lot, not thinking a lot, but talking a lot about data barriers to entry, and there's this big debate between those people who just say, you know, you don't need that many data anyway because of the law of large numbers. If you have 20 or 100 data, that's enough. Some other people who say, no, because you have, you know, it's more complex, it might be exponential, the challenging ones require even more data. Yeah. And what's your view on that, and how will you solve it if there is actually a data barrier to entry? Yeah.
So my view on that is that today, the easy way is to do the big, 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 and bigger data. This is the easy way. But I mean, we all know, I mean, because we did, you know, a little bit of stats, we know very well that after a while, you know, it plateaus anyway. So when I was talking about the 100,000 cats that we need, you know, for the cats, if we take 1 million cats, you know, it's going to be pretty much the same. It doesn't matter. So it's going to plateau. But for some very complex problems with a lot of parameters, you know, that is much more than a 2D image, I mean, it's easy to add a lot of data. And so you need actually to solve those programs, you know, a lot of data. And this is the current race that is happening right now, the race to the data. My issue is that is what I just said before, which is that race of data, this big data, is going to go directly in the wall because of the energy that it requires to store and compute. Okay. That said, now there are people that are thinking about small data or smaller data, right? So this is where we are thinking, you know, okay, we don't need that much data in order to create something that is going to be, you know, pretty much the same result than the 100,000 cats, but with only, you know, 100 cats. So that is statistically not something that we understand very well, because by definition, statistics, you know, need a certain number in order to be relevant, right? So in this case, there are people that are trying to, you know, go back to this small sample thing in order to try to do another kind of statistics that is going to make it work. So this is a current thing that people are working on, and I think that this is a very, very interesting area where we should go, because if we don't go there, we are going to, you know, explode the planet with the energy that we need. So
this is a question about regulation, which is something you've talked about. So again, AI, you know, in many cases, there's a lot of complex parameters that come into the calculation of that that transform inputs into outputs. So we observe sometimes the inputs, sometimes we don't observe the inputs, we always observe the outputs, and we have to regulate the outputs. So how do you think, you know, is the kind of the best way? Is it to go into the algorithm and try to understand what it does?
Yeah.
Or is it to try to to understand the training process or something like that, right?
So there are many aspects, you know, in the way we could do it. So as I said before also, I mean, we will need to have some algorithms that are going to help us to find, to explain, for the explainability, because explaining is halfway, you know, to adopting, yeah. Right? So we are going to need that. And it won't be a simple image, you know, like the fractal image, but it will be something else. And there are some AIs that can actually help, you know, to explain, right? Because, I mean, they are going to be able to compete with the speed and the size of those things, right? So there will be that. And it will be the thing that is going to inspect, basically, the algorithms, right? So, but that is might be too complex, even for the regulator, right? Because the regulator doesn't have the brain power to understand, you know, everything all the time, right? So we need sometimes, you know, to just this time explain to the public, to the people, you know, that are going to be using those things, what is it that we are trying to do in simple terms. And education in this case is what could be the best regulation, and vice versa. Regulation is going to be the best education. Okay, so that's what I really believe, you know, we should do at one point, is that to set the expectations. For instance, you know, today when we talk about autonomous cars, and we expect, we the public, expect that there will be pretty much zero, you know, accident, which is a totally stupid expectation, right? So, I mean, there will be accidents in any case, right? So I believe, and we know, it's for sure that there will be much less accidents, you know, with L4 cars, you know, than with what we have today. But people that don't expect that, because they say it's a robot, the robot has to be perfect. No, we have to explain that the robot cannot be perfect, you know, and that even if we have 10% accidents, you know, that's fine. That's life. That's accidents.
Going back on Dan's question here, what is it you think that social scientists in general and economists in particular should focus on? I mean, what are you feeling that are the big gaps from your
view? I love them.
I'm not asking for love, I'm asking for directions.
So what I believe, I mean, strongly, I believe in a multidisciplinary approach of any problem in science in general, I mean, any problem in general. So what I like about, you know, economists and sociologists and whatever, you know, it is that they are going to bring another point of view than what, you know, the scientists are going to bring, and that they are going to think, right? So they are going to have this other perspective that is going to help to see the world in another way and to see the problem in another way. So this is why I love, you know, when I work with other people, that people like me, right? So this is the very, very first thing.
Why don't we never talk about the impact of technology on the climate and environment? You talked about it like a little bit.
Because it's the digital economy, by definition, you know, you don't feel it. It's not tangible, right? So you have the feeling that when you have the services that you have, you know, on your phone, it's just on this little thing, you know, and it is nothing. Actually, you know, people who know, I mean, most of you here, but I mean, this is only the elite, right? They know that in the back end, there are big servers, you know, doing a lot of things, you know, to perform whatever act, you know, you are doing there. But we don't see it, because it seems all transparent, because by definition, this is digital, right? This is something that we don't feel. And this is why we don't talk about it, because it's easy as well, right? It's there, we do it. There is one example, you know, that I like to talk about all the time. This is the selfies. I hate selfies. So don't ask me selfies, you know, at the end of the thing, because the answer will be no, okay? Why? A selfie, a single selfie, okay? If you take it, of course, you know, you are not taking it for yourself, hopefully. And then, you know, you are going to share it. It's going to go up there, you know, in the server. It's going to be shared with a lot of people, you know, and you are going to brag about it, blah, blah, blah. A single selfie, it equals a bulb, a 60-watt bulb burning for 24 hours. There is 1 billion selfies taken every day. This is ridiculous. So think about it. Stop the selfies.
Yeah, I have one question. So you said mistakes will happen, accidents will happen. So do you think accountability is a problem?
Yeah, I mean, so now, you know, we can talk about some very interesting things that who is going to be accountable? Is it the car? Is it the guy, you know, who owns the car? Is it the car builder? Is it, you know, the guy who did just cross the road, you know? So, of course, there we are going to have somehow, somewhere, regulation. So accountability is going to go with regulation somehow. So we are going to have to say something about it. I'm not the regulator, I don't know. I have my feeling, you know, I feel that, you know, somehow life is random, you know. So I don't want the car to say, you know, I'm the strongest one and I'm going to protect the guys, you know, in my car, and I don't care about the rest of the world. So I don't think it's the right thing to do. I think random is the best thing to do, but I mean, the regulator will have to regulate at one point and say, you know, car makers, this is the way it is. But you, public, you know, there will be accidents. Be ready for that. Don't expect that the car is going to protect you 100% of the time.
Just what is it you're doing at Samsung on AI? I mean, is it just trying to build as many of these colored bars that are on the graph there, adding stuff, or is it something different?
So I never talk about Samsung, but I'm going to tell you what I'm doing at Samsung. I'm doing something that I feel, me personally, with my ethical view of life, you know, is the good thing to do. What is the good thing to do is not to create yet, you know, another 10,000 of those bars, because, you know, it's going directly in the wall. So what I'm trying to do is actually to create something that is going to look at AI going in another direction of AI. Not in the biology one, because I don't understand anything about biology, but with the mathematics, as I said before, trying to shrink the models, trying to make those models, you know, needing less data, having those things being done at the edge instead of, you know, on the servers, you know, that are going to be all centralized, so trying to decentralize. So all those problems that I'm trying to do, which are basically trying to save the planet, you know, through AI, but keeping the promise of AI, because we have a lot of things to do that are going to be incredible, but we need to be just careful when we are doing it. I mean, creating yet another, you know, Go machine at 440 kilowatts to be a very, very, very stupid thing to do. And this is unfortunately what people just did with yet another game recently.
Yes. I was wondering, what is your view on the use of AI in things like art or music? Do you think AI would be better than human in creating this kind of stuff? Would it be possible for AI to exhaust all the possibilities of music composition one day?
Yeah, random is going to be nice, huh? It's going to sound very good. Yeah. Okay, what I think that AI doesn't create. AI doesn't invent. AI is not creative. AI is not interesting if you ask it to do something that was never done before. Okay, this is what I think. So now, you know, people tell me, yeah, but look, I mean, this is unbelievable. This thing, you know, it did create a song like the Beatles, you know. I said, great. Perfect. Why? Okay. Why? Because I gave it, you know, all the Beatles songs, you know, over the 60 years or whatever, you know, they think, and, you know, it created a song like the Beatles. Great. Good.